we're beginners. And we shine our light so bright that we make them say, whoa. Everybody lift it up, say we are.
We are Christ representatives.
We gotta let the whole world know that
we are
Christ representatives. See, and we shine our light, yeah. That we make them say, whoa. We gotta let them know that we are
Christ representatives.
We are, we are, we are. We're the light of the world, we're a city on a hill. Jesus is real, and we go by the name that's the greatest in the land. Oh, everybody don't understand that's cool, but
we are,
yeah. Look in the mirror and realize
we are,
see, and we shine out. So bright that we make them say, whoa, ooh, we are, we are, we are.
Get the one who gave us life. So we've been turning living rooms into life rooms. Hey, we've been turning living rooms into life rooms. We've been giving God room with these life tunes. We just get too busy living and watching others live that we forget the one who gave us life. So we've been turning living rooms into life rooms.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to New Covenant Church. Go ahead and stand on your feet. We're going to worship Jesus.
One thing to know your presence.
This song, like, there is nothing like knowing God or being near to Him, being close to Him. And I realize you probably had a crazy week. I had a crazy week. And also, we have the chance right now to choose to connect with God, right? Worship is like the thermostat of the soul, you know? And when you choose to worship, no matter what the temperature is, everything warms up around that, you know? So this morning, if you're feeling a little cold, it's all right. You know, I woke up feeling a little cold this morning spiritually, and that's why we choose to worship, all right? Go ahead and turn to somebody next to you, give them a high five, a handshake, a wink, a nudge, a hug. Go ahead and move out of your seats. Find a couple people that you've never met before, greet them like you like them.
Pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken in the name of Jesus. Enemies defeated, and we will shout it out, shout it out.
I will live, I will not die.
The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free in Jesus' name.
And we have come together in this place today because we want to meet with you, God. We need to connect with you and to hear your word and for our hearts to be encouraged, for us to be reminded of who you are, of how beautiful and powerful your name is, and to be reminded of our purpose. So God, we honor you this morning. We praise your name, and we ask that you would continue to meet us in this place. In Jesus' powerful name we pray, amen. Amen. Good morning, New Covenant. You can take a seat. My name is Nikki.
And I'm Lee.
And we're here to give you a very warm welcome. We're so glad you guys have joined us today here in person, and then those of you who have joined us online, hello. And if this is your first time here, please don't leave today without introducing yourselves to somebody. We've got a super friendly person at the Connect Desk. So on your way out, you can introduce yourselves to Rob back there. And if there's any way, whether you're new or not new, that we can support you or pray for you, please let us know by filling out a Connect card. So you can find those in the seat pockets there where you're seated this morning, or you can access those digitally. So if you open up the text app on your phone and type in the word wholeness to the number 94,000, the instructions are right there on the screen, that will shoot you a link right away. And then when you click the link, it will bring you to our dashboard. So the dashboard is like a secret portal into the New Covenant world. So definitely check out the dashboard because it's going to have information about all the things that Lee and I tell you about today. It's also a great way to give of your tithes and offerings. One of our values here is that generosity matters. And so we want to give of our time, of our gifts and talents. We also want to give of our financial blessings as an act of worship to the Lord. So if you'd like to do that, you can do it on the dashboard or at our website, or you can give using the envelopes and the drop box in the back of the room. What is going on this week, Lee?
You guys, this week is jam-packed coming up this next weekend. Yeah. And Friday is the Men's Night of Worship event.
Woohoo!
Where are my boys
Let's
at?
Let's hear it, men.
It's going to be an amazing time, guys, of just worship. And if you're like me, connecting with the Lord through song and just praising Him in that time is just such an intimate way to connect. It's also going to just be a great time for prayer for one another. We're going to hear from another guy in the body that's just going to speak to us a little bit. But I'm just really looking forward to seeing all of you guys there. It's going to be a great night.
Invite somebody to join you Friday
night. Somebody.
For sure. And then the very next day, we actually have a brunch for the ladies. So Saturday, woo! Saturday, we have a brunch. Now, this event you have to sign up for, and the deadline is tomorrow night, gals. So you got to get on it. Today is like your last day. Hop onto the dashboard, click the link, register for the ladies' brunch. You guys, we have a guest speaker who is amazing. She's going to make us laugh. She's going to make us cry.
Regret.
Thank you. Regret.
You're welcome.
You're not going to regret it. So please join us. There's even childcare if you need it. I'll be in the back along with Cindy Sherman after the service today to help everybody register. That way you guys can get signed up in time. And then what else? The next day.
We also have a young adult social that's going to be happening at Modera in Coral Springs. When I was a young adult, I went to a lot of these things, and that's actually how I met some of my best friends in the world, and some of them are in this room, actually, right
that's
now.
That's awesome.
So, I would encourage you young adults to get out there. It's going to be Sunday, the 28th, starting at 5:30 in Coral Springs. If you text wholeness to 94,000, there will be an address, more information on there for you guys to check that out. But I would encourage you guys to be part of that stuff.
Definitely. Ages 18 through 20-somethings. Yeah. And Cove Camp.
Oh, yes.
It's coming
I've
up.
Heard of Cove Camp. It's starting at some point.
It's starting this summer.
What makes Cove Camp, like, exciting? I've heard, like, all this jazz about it. What's going on with that?
Lee, I am so glad you asked about that. Cove Camp is going to be a blast. We are going to have a theme every single week, and the first theme of Cove Camp this summer is going to be Hawaii.
Ooh.
So please sign your kids up, but even more than that, get involved. You can volunteer if you follow on the dashboard, click the link that says Cove Camp, and there's actually options there where you can volunteer for our like pre-Cove Camp day, which is going to be May 18th, just putting together all of the craft packets and all that stuff, or you can sponsor a child. So there's more on that link than just registering a child. There's more information. So if you're sitting in here this morning, please click that link, find out how you can be involved to make Cove Camp happen. It's going to be so much fun. And
great. So today we're going to be starting a brand new series. It's going to be incredible. So youth, you guys are dismissed to head upstairs. And if you all would take a look at the screens, we're going to get started.
We look up to the stars and are left wondering. Since the beginning of creation, mankind has been searching for answers. How to live, how to love, how to be happy, how to just be okay. If we could only solve this puzzle, we look at the ground beneath our feet and are left wanting. We look up to the stars and are left wondering. Science, psychology, and religion have failed us, but the designer of all things holds the answers. Only he has cracked the code.
Well, good morning. How are you today? Happy Sunday. It is good to be together. Sorry for our technical difficulties, but we got it. Today we are going to be in the book of Matthew. We are starting a series out of the Sermon on the Mount, and this is going to take us, we're going to be here for a little bit, because it's jam-packed full of great things, and so we're calling it The Code, and you'll see why calling it that in a little bit, but for those who don't know me, my name is Adam. I'm the pastor here at the church and want to welcome you. So glad that you're with us. And if you're joining us from home or online, we are just super excited that you would even tune in this morning. So the book of Matthew, first book in the New Testament. So if you're looking, if you're in the middle of your Bible, just turn right for a while. And we're going to be in Matthew chapter 5 in the first 10 verses of Matthew 5. If you need a Bible, there's Bibles around your chairs. The text will be on the screen for you as well. This is what Matthew 5, 1 to 10, this is what it says. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them. He taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." This is God's word. Let's pray. Lord, we hear your words here. We read them. Many of our Bibles have red letters. This means it's coming directly from Jesus' mouth. And we are interested. We want to be changed. We need a word outside of ourselves to help us to understand this world, to understand our lives, to understand life in general. So would you speak to us through these words? Would you help us to be changed and affected by you and who you are? May your spirit convict us of the things that need to be changed and encourage us with the areas that where we are heading in the right direction. All for your glory, God, and our joy, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We've been talking the last couple weeks about the implications of the gospel and just how the gospel shapes us and what it looks like for us to be, to live a life that is reflecting our system of beliefs. And today we enter into a whole new realm of what that is going to look like for us. We talked the last 2 weeks about being a part of a community and what that looks like and the importance of community life and that it's sometimes just hard to be part of a community. Entering a new community can be difficult. There are new things that have to be learned. There's rules that exist in those communities. And sometimes there's written rules. There's written things that we understand that are outlined. You know, you go to a public pool, it's like, here are the rules. You know, don't dive. Don't bring glass. Don't do this stuff. You join a gym, there's lots of paperwork for you to sign and the waivers and the rules and regulations of what they expect. But then there are things that just are not explicit. It's the unwritten rules sometimes that can be the hardest things to understand, the hardest things to figure out because there is a system that exists that we may not be so aware of, right? You join a new gym, yeah, you're going to learn about checking in, checking out, bathrooms, and all this stuff, but there's just some stuff, some etiquette things that they don't put down in writing. Things like if you're on a piece of machinery, don't take too long. Don't just sit on your phone scrolling through social media or texting while people are waiting to get on. If you're using dumbbells, don't stand in front of the dumbbell rack while you are taking all the space in the world because other people need to go do that. I've talked about this before. For the past decade or so, I've done CrossFit. We have a few CrossFitters in here and we're big on community, and when you enter that community, you're part of it and all this great stuff. But there is a whole language that has to be learned, and if you don't learn it, you're gonna feel left out. The words that you understand the English of it, you understand that there are these letters I get, but when you put them together, I don't understand what they mean. Words like AMRAP or EMOM or SDHL, WAD is the big one for us. And unless you know that means workout of the day or every minute on the minute or as many rounds as possible, like you hear a coach throwing out these words, but it's like you need a secret decoder ring to figure out what's going on so you can just feel like you're part of the community, right? Entering into community is challenging because you don't know the landscape. You don't know what's happening and how am I supposed to get involved and get to this place of unity or community if I don't know what is going on. There's a set of standards in every community that shape your experience in that. There's a code. And when you crack that code, when you understand what's going on and learn to live by that code, that set of values, you and everyone in the community thrives. It's no different in God's community. We all exist in communities that have a code, and it is no different in God's family, his kingdom, his city, his community. There are a set of values that define how we are going to live. We all have that, right? In our home, on our team, in our job. Our church has a set of values that has a code that we live by that help direct how we make decisions. We phrase them in terms of what matters. You heard Nikki allude to it. Here are the five values that we live by. And there's an order for a purpose. Truth matters. The Bible defines reality for us. Worship matters. We all worship something. We need to worship the right thing. People matter. Love God and love people. Love your neighbor as yourself. You matter. We matter. This city matters. Growth matters, that we are never wanting to be stagnant in our lives, but that we are called to grow and to keep growing in our faith and in how we're expressing that faith. And then generosity matters, that God has given us so much that we are to give back in every way imaginable, whether our time, our talent, our treasure. So these values, they set up for us. This is our code. We really make decisions about using this, and we pray it, we value it, we live it. So this is what we are going to study for the next several months, this sermon that's called the Sermon on the Mount, often called the greatest sermon ever told, ever preached, Jesus' first sermon, public sermon. The Gospel of Matthew is split up into five, we call them discourses, spread throughout the whole book, but this is the first one. He begins his ministry and ends his ministry with very powerful sermons. And so this one, the Sermon on the Mount, meaning, and you saw when we read it, he went up to a hillside partway up so that he could speak over the people and he taught. This sermon that he gives us in Matthew 5, 6, and 7, it gives us the ethics of his community. Big code word here is kingdom. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. We don't think in terms of kingdoms because our whole country is built off of not following kings. But we belong, if we are part of God's family, we are part of a kingdom where he is king and we live in this city within a city, this kingdom within a kingdom. And when we submit our lives to God, when we submit our lives to Jesus, we enter into a system of life. So how we live when we are submitted to Christ is outlined in these next three chapters, and it is deep and it is thick. So when I say code or the code, I'm talking about a system of life. I'm not talking about just a code of laws or rules and regulations. No, it's a framework to which we experience living life. We all have decisions to make every day in how we live with one another, how we live with God, how we live with our family, how we work, how we play. And this system, this code that he gives us, it transcends everything for us. It transcends culture, transcends race, transcends gender, socioeconomic status. This sermon tells us what it means to follow Jesus. So that's what we're going to talk about today, what it looks like to follow him. This is the law of Christ. And it really is, it's fascinating because if you're familiar with the Bible at all or any stories from the Bible, like the Old Testament story of Moses, right? We know of Moses being this figure who goes into Egypt and rescues the people of Israel, God's people, from slavery, from captivity to set them free. And we know the miracles that exist around there. And then when they're out in the wilderness, they're out in the desert, he goes up to the mountain. He receives the law of God. What do we call that law of God? Ten Commandments. And he comes back down the mountain, and a little bit of trouble ensues first, but he then gives the law. First, he throws it at them because they're being silly. But he goes and gets it again. He comes back down, and he lets the people of Israel know this is what it means to live in God's kingdom. And so now Jesus comes, and Matthew really does present this as a newer and greater Moses that comes to receive, who has the law of God in him, and he fleshes out the law in way more nuanced manner. That's why you see, as we will go through this sermon, you know, when we talk about anger, he says, like, oh, you heard it was said, don't kill, right? Ten Commandment, don't murder. And Jesus comes and says, I'm telling you what, if you have hatred in your heart, you've sinned, and you're liable for that sin. So Jesus comes and just flips our universe upside down, flips the Jewish world upside down, because they were thinking, I'm doing pretty good. I have not murdered today. So I was like, check. Then he's like, do you have any hatred in your heart? And he goes through that over and over. So Jesus is presented as this new Moses coming, a better Moses, the perfect Moses, where Moses couldn't fully deliver the people of Israel out of captivity. Jesus comes to give this greater fulfillment of freedom and release than ever they could have imagined. So he gives us this greater description of how those Ten Commandments play out in our lives so that we can live with a passion for God, not just a bunch of rules to follow, but a passion to live for him, so that we would not be so entangled, we would not entangle our faith so much inappropriately with political strategies or American ideals or religious practices or moralistic pressures. Sometimes our lives are so knotted up with these things, we can't distinguish one from the other. Even our best things that we do, you being here right now, it's wonderful. But if your 52 weeks a year on Sunday is your greatest measure of your Christian faith, it's just not enough. You're like, well, what's enough? Well, we're going to talk about that. So this sermon offers us so, so, so much more. It offers us a life of joy to follow Jesus freely. free of those entanglements, to decouple ourselves from the things that want to grab our attention and make us think they are the most important things to do. Because those things are important, but they are not the goal. Those things will be impacted. Sure, our family, our marriage, our work, our voting, our church life, religious practices, they'll be impacted when we are fully joyful in the act of following God. Following Jesus will make us more impactful in this world if we hear the heart of his words in this sermon. And so we're going to spend a lot of time on it. The question is, are you ready to listen? All right, Ryan's ready. Do you guys have coffee today? Like, are we okay? It's a little slumber over here today. Yeah, come on. I'm gonna try to wake you up. These first 10 verses are really the introduction to the sermon. They are part of the sermon, but they are his intro, and they are so important, right? I'm going to give us a bit of an overview of the whole sermon, but really we're going to focus on these 10 verses in an overview type of way, because Jesus starts the sermon so impactful. And so what we're going to learn through this whole series, but especially today in these first 10 verses, are three things. Jesus is going to show us who we are, what we do, and why it all matters. Who we are, what we do, and why it matters. Very simple. And we're going to spend a lot of time on this who we are stuff again, because this is the most important part of anything that we can do, anything that I can give you. We've been talking about the implications of the gospel and the importance of knowing who you are before knowing what you do. And we just don't love that, because honestly, I just don't want to talk about who I am. I just want to know what I need to do, what I don't need to do. Just give me the guidelines, give me my job description, give me my goals, I'll follow them, I'll hit it, and I'll get exceeds expectations and or meets, and I'll move on. Let's not get into the whole inner me nonsense. But this is so important and valuable to understanding how we live this sermon. Because that's what Jesus does in the first part of this first major sermon. Let me show you how this kind of plays out. So there's some background here, right? Matthew, you know, this is chapter 5. So there's been chapters 1, 2, 3, 4. So Jesus is born. He's growing up. We learn about some things about his history. And then we jump into this part of Jesus' life where he goes into the desert, into the wilderness for 40 days. He fasts. He has this encounter with the devil. The devil tries to make him take shortcuts in doing what he needed to do. And he attacks his being, his personhood. He says, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God. So it's no surprise that we start this sermon with him focusing on who we are, our identity, our personhood. Jesus overcomes his time with the devil, and then Matthew quotes Isaiah to set the scene and introduce the sermon. And this is verse 16, chapter 4. He says, the people dwelling in darkness, this is a quote from Isaiah from the Old Testament. Matthew quotes this to show this is a prophetic fulfillment. He says, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them a light has dawned. Right? Okay, so I'm going to explain all this in a little bit. And then it says that Jesus began his ministry. In verse 17, the next verse there, he says, from that time, Jesus began to preach, saying, repent for the, say the word, kingdom of heaven is at hand. So we've got this language of darkness and light shining. Jesus comes in and says, repent, for the kingdom is here. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then Jesus starts to walk around. He finds some disciples, Peter and Andrew, the first two disciples, and he tells them in verse 19, a couple of verses later, he says to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. So this is just some boom, boom, boom stuff happening right before this sermon. This is what leads us into the Sermon on the Mount. And so maybe you don't see the connection, but it's there. Here's what's happening. We have this image of darkness and light, really powerful, right? Anytime those images are there, it's huge, because what happens when light shines? It reveals truth. It reveals reality. It reveals who you are, right? Land of darkness. Everybody's got darkness in them. Jesus comes, brings light. And then we have this kingdom talk, letting us know that you are part of a kingdom, a community that is unlike anything you have ever known. And then he meets these disciples, and he gives them a purpose, an identity. He says, you're no longer going to be fishermen. You're going to be fishers of men. And you're like, well, what's the difference? It's a big difference. It's not just about your job, your occupation. Your purpose is going to be so much bigger. Your purpose is not to go catch fish in the water. Your purpose is to go bring people into this new, bright kingdom. It's identity. Let me tell you who you are, Peter and Andrew. You are so much more than fishermen. You're going to be evangelists. You are something bigger than what you do. He's saying that life's meaning is going to come by following me. He says, just follow me. Follow me. And I will show you who you are. We live our lives trying to find meaning in this world, trying to find purpose. Our culture elevates extreme humanism, extreme individualism to discover that purpose, that meaning. We have convinced ourselves that life has no overarching meaning, and so the only thing left for us to do is to make it up, to figure it out on our own. To invent our own meaning, to invent our own significance. And so then we start to find it in our own creations. We try to find it in our career, in our family, in our sexuality, in our race, our gender, our politics. All of those things are so important and so crucial to who we are as people, but they are not the foundational defining marks of our existence. We wonder so hard, we work so hard and wonder so hard to find meaning in life that we neglect. We're looking for meaning so hard that we forget that we need something bigger, something better. Not just meaning, we need salvation. We need rescuing from our own attempts to just figure it out and invent and create our own sense of worth and significance. And in the endless pursuit of subjective identity, what do we find? Just more emptiness. Right? Can we just be honest about that? I mean, we all do. I don't care how long you've been in the faith or if you're in no faith. Like, we just try. We run to things that are going to tell us we're good. We're enough. We're worth it. We're seen. But what happens? We just pursue and pursue and pursue. We end up more empty. The father of this kind of thought was the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, right? He's famous for saying, God is dead. God remains dead, and we've killed him. Famous line from him. But further in that same line of reasoning, he wrote this. He said, how shall we comfort ourselves, right, in light of us killing God? What water is there for us to clean ourselves? What festivals of atonement? What sacred games shall we have to invent? Saying we got to deal with this new sense of, we thought for so long that God was the center of all things, but he was, you know, convinced that there was no God, and human reason was going to take over, humanism, individualism, and so we better figure out some things that are going to make us feel better about our emptiness in this life. It's dark, man. It's bleak. Another writer and a professor at Columbia University, he wrote this: as people spin faster and faster in the pursuit of merely personal happiness, they become exhausted in the futile effort of chasing themselves. Right? You ever see a dog chase his tail? Just like, you dummy. When we remove God as the foundation, as anything, right, we are stuck. We are there creating our own designs, our own inventions, our own sense of significance and worth, and we chase that, and it ends up us chasing ourselves, and we look like the dog just spinning around and around and around, chasing our tails. Even Christians fall into this trap. We think the stuff that we do, we need more Bible studies, we need more sermons, we need more church attendance, we need more to give more. We think all these things are going to be enough to fight off the impact of this type of culture, this culture that tells us that we need to figure it out and just be our most truest selves. As long as we create it, then we can be it. And it's exhausting, it fails, and it's a lie. Even the best things that we try to do, if we're just trying to fill the gap, we will be in trouble. We have to run back to the foundation of who we are. Because if we just keep running towards the things that we have to do, we will fall into the same pit over and over and over again, and we'll just try to find new ways to get out of that pit and then just run right into the next pit. So we have to run back to the foundation of who we are. And that's what Jesus gives us right here in the Sermon on the Mount. It gives us, this sermon gives us the life-transforming impact of the gospel. And it begins with this first section. This first section, these 10 verses, gives us 8 things. And we call them the Beatitudes. Jesus didn't use that word. We did. Okay? The Beatitudes, pretty self-explanatory. Be these attitudes. That's it. Like, and that's what they are. They are an attitude, right? This is where you see the code words on display, right? The words blessed and the word kingdom. Those are like really important that we understand what those two words mean before we get into the meat of the sermon. Because the meat of the sermon is what we all long for. It's like, oh, what do I do with when I'm angry? What do I do when I lust? What do I do when I'm anxious? What do I do when other people hurt me? But my argument is this: if we don't really embrace the Beatitudes, these first things, and we're going to talk about it in a second, when we get to the next part, you will be crushed by it. You will hate it. Stay tuned. These Beatitudes are super important because, they're not just a self-help list to achieve your greatest possible life, right? This is the essence of what it means to follow Jesus. Those things that I read in the beginning, we're going to look at them in a second, they are what it means to follow Jesus. They are a description of the person who has been found by Jesus Christ. God's people are characterized by these 8 emotional attitudes. They're qualities of the inner person who is submitted to Jesus. You don't do these things in order to find God. You are these things when God has found you. That's good? I'll say it again. Just a little feedback helps a lot. I mean, I don't know. I was saying if you guys are awake or not today. A couple of things is good. You don't do these things in order to find God. You are these things when God has found you. This is an identity list. Yes, it's who you are. I'm going to explain why. Because you read it. Blessed are. Right there, it should help. Blessed are poor in spirit, those who mourn, the meek, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the merciful, the pure in heart, the peacemakers, those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are these things, right? And so you see that list and you might think, man, what a downer. Like, my gosh, Christianity is sad. A bunch of sad people who are at the end of their rope, who are not good at anything. And so if you're like a strong, confident, intelligent, educated person, you're like, well, I guess I'm out. This is only for the dummies of the world and the broken and who have nothing, you know, or broke and broken. Obviously, that's not the case. This is not a list of life's hopeless cases. You don't need to become these things in order for God to love you. The Beatitudes are not this description of a messed up life you need to have in order for God to notice you. Because some people think that's what it is. That's why I'm saying it over and over and over again. Like, hey, look at who the kingdom of God is open to. The homeless, the poor, yes. But that's not what this is highlighting. This is what makes the Sermon on the Mount so countercultural. Each beatitude is something so much more powerful, and it hits us down at the very core of our existence. Doug Webster, he says it this way. He says, each beatitude is a description of grace-shaped receptivity to the will of God. Each beatitude is a description of grace-shaped receptivity to the will of God. People want to know what it means to have faith in Jesus. It's this list. It's not about what you do. It's about who you are. It's a heart condition. All those emotional attitudes are something that has to be so deep inside of us. You cannot muster that up. Like, blessed are those who mourn. Okay, because I got to cry. If I cry more, God will be open to me. Poor in spirit? I don't know how to do that. I'm poor financially, but I'm not so poor in spirit. I don't even know what that means. Look, that list, if I can you put that up one more time, Steph, the previous list? Like, these are not individual characteristics. They are a continuum, one that plays into the other, and they all intersect and interact in a very important way. It's one list said in different ways, like colors of a rainbow. And when the light shines, like we talked about earlier, right? There's darkness, light is shining in. When light shines in, this list refracts that light in an array of colors. So you can't be poor in spirit but not meek or pure in heart. Like, I'm going to be all of them, but I am no peacemaker. No, it can't be. That's not it. That's not how it works. Doug Webster, who I just quoted a second ago, he writes this. He says, the Beatitudes celebrate the life we have received by faith, not the life we have achieved by our effort. They remind us of God's work, not our performance. We never graduate from the Beatitudes, nor retire from their personal significance. Do you hear that? They celebrate the life we've received by faith, not the life we've achieved by effort. And some of us are just trying to achieve that life by effort. And the Sermon on the Mount comes in like a freight train to show us it can't happen. So the Beatitudes are this like on-ramp to the sermon, an on-ramp that help us to see, okay, we need to get our hearts right before we start learning about what anger means. So that's the second part, what we do, right? The Sermon on the Mount is going to speak to us about every aspect of life. It's going to talk about how we relate to the world around us. It's going to talk to us about, you know, with like salt and light images, how we relate to people in our lives, anger and lust, integrity with our bodies and our words. Talking about how we view sex, how we view oaths. How are we going to deal with hatred, with prayer, money, anxiety, how we judge other people, right? We're going to get to all that stuff. And Jesus says, if you live this way, if you live this Sermon on the Mount, you are going to be the light of the world. Like, you are going to shine so bright in a darkened world. People can't help but see that you are different and that you belong to someone different. But here's the problem. As much as we will stand out if we live by this sermon, if we don't begin the right way with these Beatitudes, if we don't understand the foundation correctly, then we can think, we can fall into this, because this is definitely something we may feel, or definitely the world around us may feel. I don't have to believe much about Jesus. I just have to do what he says. I'm just going to live, you know, the golden rule. Just live well, love well. Forget Jesus' birth, life, death, resurrection. Maybe, I don't know. As long as I live the right way, as long as I do what the Sermon on the Mount says, then I will be good. That's not it. And God help us if we skip over the Beatitudes and just jump right into being salt and light in this world. Because if we don't have the foundation right, if we don't know who we are and who God is, then we're going to get to the meat of the Sermon on the Mount and we will hate it. It will crush us. It will make us turn and walk away. Because it's impossible. You're saying, well, that's not fair. You just said, if we live by it, then we'll stand out and, you know, we'll be the light of the world, but you're saying, I can't follow it, so are we destined to live in darkness? It's a really good question. And we'll answer that as we go along in this series. But think about this. Once we get into the meat of it, we're gonna see how living this way is impossible. And we know it's impossible, but we expect everyone else to live the Sermon on the Mount as it relates to us. We want people to treat us the way the Sermon on the Mount talks about love, grace, and anxiousness, anxiety, hatred, words, judging, right? How many times do you say, don't judge? While you're just like destroying them for, you're judging them for judging. We expect everyone else around us to be in complete alignment with the Sermon on the Mount, but we know ourselves that it's impossible. And so we find ourselves in a bit of a paradox, in a conundrum. We know we can't live up to it, and we hope and pray everyone else does. So what do we do to get ready for the sermon? How do we crack this code? How do we think about the code? It's maybe a lot simpler than you want it to be, but this is one word. What do? With the Beatitudes as we get into the Sermon on the Mount? We believe. Sorry, it's not more sexy than that. Believe. Simple word. Crazy complex to live out. We have to believe that Jesus is Lord. We have to submit to him and be changed. The Sermon on the Mount gives us prescriptions for life. It does. It will help us how we ought to live, how we ought to think, how our attitudes should be. But before we can live like that, we must be changed. All the language of the Beatitudes are describing someone who is a Christian or is becoming a Christian. You cannot do any of those things in and of yourself. God has to be working in you. Before someone can live like the sermon wants us to live, we have to be changed. Something has to happen to us and in us, and that is the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes have to be attituded into us. TM. Before you can live the Sermon on the Mount, you have to encounter and experience the Beatitudes really deep inside. You must become a new person. The only way to follow the Sermon on the Mount is to become new, is to be made new. Paul says it later on in his letters. He says, I'm a new creation. We are a new creation in Christ. The old has passed away. The new has come. Like that is what we do. We believe because we cannot be made new ourselves. We cannot be reborn ourselves. Jesus explains that in his ministry. He says, you got to be born again. Jewish guy was like, that's weird. How can I be born? Yes, it has to come from the Spirit. So you have to believe. Your spirit, your heart has to be willing and open and receptive to the word of God that's being spoken to you through his word, being spoken to you right now. You're like, yeah, I'm a Christian. Are you? Have you submitted your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? Or are you just a Christian because you come to church every now and again? Or every week? You give lots of money. You sing. You're friendly. You pour coffee. You go work at the homeless shelter. You're nice to your boss. You hold the values of the Christian church in your politics. There's some scary statements in the Bible where people come to face the Lord on the day. He's like, and we're going to stand there. Hey, God, I did these great things. Remember? And if you know what God says, it all starts here. God says, I never knew you. Oh, you lived the Sermon on the Mount? You missed the Beatitudes. Because those who mourn and are meek and who hunger and thirst for righteousness and who are poor in spirit, those are the ones whom I have met because they're operating with a different set of values, a different language. It's a different code. We believe. The Beatitudes are a description of the kind of person we must be before we can do the things Jesus calls us to do. Do you know who you are? Now the team, come on up. Do you know who you are? Is your identity fixed? Meaning you've put your faith in Jesus. Because look, the Beatitudes, you say, okay, what do we need to do? You need to see all those, read them, meditate on them, and ask yourself, examine your life and say, is this a description in any way of my heart? And now if you're a Christian or non-Christian, both alike, you should look at that and be like, I'm working on it. Got a long way to go. But are you submitted to allowing God to change you and to shape you? So why does this all matter? Because nothing will change your life. Nothing will change your life like the Sermon on the Mount. It will wreck you when we read it. We're going to go through it like 20 sections. Yep. So we got a lot of weeks. Nothing will change your life or challenge your life like the Sermon on the Mount. But nothing will be more important than getting this part first. Getting this part right first. Truly, knowing our identity is everything. It's the most important thing in your life. To know that we don't just need improvement. We don't just sort of need God. We need a complete makeover. We need Him to rule over us. We need something bigger, better, something perfect. And listen, this is the key, okay? Been building up to it, and this is it. If you remember nothing else, remember this. Because the reality is that the Beatitudes describe, right? Blessed is this person, blessed is this person, blessed is this person. It describes someone who is a hero. It describes someone who is perfect, who is perfectly blessed, right? Blessed are, blessed are, blessed are. It's describing this complete blessing that comes to an individual. Well, listen. The one who is perfectly poor in spirit, perfectly mourned, perfectly meek, fully hungers and thirsts, merciful, ultimate peacemaker, the Beatitudes describe Jesus. He's describing Himself. Before they do describe us, but before they describe you and me, they describe Him. So that He is the one who goes before us, and we get to keep in step with Him. We get to look to Him, the author and finisher of our faith. Why can you and I be rich as kings? It's because He became poor in spirit. Why can you and I be comforted? Because He mourned fully and ultimately. Why are you and I inheriting the earth? Because He became meek. He was stripped of everything. Why are you and I obtaining mercy? Because He got none. Why are you and I someday be able to see God? Because He was pure. He fulfilled all these Beatitudes one by one by one by one, so that you and I could look at them and not be crushed by them, but be open to them and say, yes, Lord, this is what I want. I want a life that is full of these things. Not just to walk around with my head down, thinking I'm defeated. No, this is not a defeatist list. This is a victorious list that helps us to understand the strength that we have in God, in Christ, that we can live a life of inner strength by recognizing that we are utterly dependent upon Him. That's what poor in spirit means. You've got nothing to bring. It's all spent. And He can just come and invest all of that into you. Do you know Him? Do you believe, right? Who do you know who you are? Do you know what you're to do and how that looks in your life? Belief. Believe in your heart that Jesus is the Lord, the Son of God, that He was born, lived, died, rose from the grave for the forgiveness of your sins, yours and my sins. You believe that in your heart and you confess it with your mouth. He says, He's there. And so, before we can jump into learning how to figure out our anger, we have to figure out what the condition of our heart needs to be and how exciting this is. And so then we can surrender all the things, all the identity issues that we experience from day to day, how beautiful we are, how successful, how we define life, how we vote, how powerful we are. We can lay it all down and say, God, You define me. I'm created in Your image. So here, Beatitude, let's go. Poor in spirit, God, help me. We can pray this. That's what I want to encourage you to do this week. Take the Beatitudes. 10 verses, eight descriptions, and you can pray them every day. Ask God, say, Lord, I recognize my inability to be this, but You can make me this. You will make me this. help me, show me what it means to be poor in spirit, what it means to mourn, what it means. And you're like, Adam, I was hoping you would tell me more about what each of these mean. I understand. We had to go through a little bit of overview today. This is not hard. The harder part is submitting your life to God and understanding that you need to go to Him for Him to help define what these look like in your life. And one way that we get to do this together is by taking the Lord's Supper. I'm going to tell you this. If you want to read the Sermon on the Mount for these next few months, the sermon will take you about 15 minutes to read through. And this is what G.K. Chesterton said. He said, on the first reading of the Sermon on the Mount, you feel that it turns everything upside down. But the second time you read it, you discover that it turns everything right side up. The first time you read it, you feel that it is impossible, but the second time you feel that nothing else is possible. Man, that's what we need. Read it once, read it twice, read it 10 times. Go to God in humble prayer and say, God, help me. Today we get to take the Lord's Supper together. If you haven't gotten one of your elements yet, you can go ahead into the back and grab it on a table. But this meal is for the one who has been made right, who's been saved by God, someone who's wanting the Beatitudes' existence in their life. If you've not put your faith in Christ yet, if you're exploring, then this is a time for you to examine your life, examine your heart, examine your belief. And just pray. We're going to sing a song. We're going to sing over you a bit while we meditate. We're told when we take these elements, the bread and the wine, that we are to examine our lives, to be reminded of what Jesus has done for us. So let's do that. So don't take the elements yet. Just let's sing it over. And I'm going to come back up and we're going to take them together and close out the service. So yeah, you can stay seated. Let's pray though. God, we are grateful for who you are. We are thankful, God, for the cross. We are thankful for your greatness, your infinite creator nature. But you're also a father, you're a brother, you're a friend. No greater love has someone than this, than he lays down his life for his friends. That's what you have done. So help us to examine our lives in light of that. How can we lay our lives down for you, for our brothers and sisters? Remind us of your great love for us. In Jesus' name, amen. So you want to stand, you can stand. If you want to stay seated, you can sit. But we're going to just meditate for a few minutes here.
Creation, there at the start.